Welcome, my friends. In this video, we will be introducing confidence intervals, which means we are venturing into inferential statistics. Recall that statistics can be broken into two broad categories. Descriptive statistics deals with organizing and summarizing data. This includes things like charts and graphs to help us understand and communicate data, as well as calculating things like averages or variances. Inferential statistics is about drawing conclusions from sample data using probability theory. Inferential statistics includes things like confidence intervals, which we'll be introducing here, and hypothesis testing, which we will cover in future videos. Let's start off by reviewing the difference between a statistic and a parameter. A statistic is a number that describes some aspect of the sample. A parameter is some number that describes an aspect of the population. Examples of statistics are x bar for the mean, s for the standard deviation, and p hat or p prime for a proportion. These values are all calculated based on a sample, which is why we call them statistics. Examples of parameters are mu for the mean, sigma for the standard deviation, and p for the proportion. These values all represent numbers relating to the population, which is why they are parameters. One small problem, though. Population parameters are virtually always unknown. Populations are large, and it's typically impossible to gather data from every individual in a population. The solution is to take samples to calculate statistics. These statistics will become point estimates for their corresponding population parameters. A point estimate is just an estimate of a population parameter using one number, typically a statistic. As samples rarely, if ever, perfectly represent the population, it's better not to rely on a point estimate, but instead a range of values to help us estimate the population parameter. This is what we call a confidence interval. For example, I might sample 15 professional pianists and find that they practice an average of 5 hours per day. 5 hours came from a sample, so that makes it a statistic, represented by x bar, which is a point estimate for the population mean mu of daily practice time of all professional pianists. But I didn't sample all professional pianists. There are thousands or perhaps millions of professional pianists that I didn't gather data from. There is a very high chance that this estimate is not exactly right. It might be too large or too small. For that reason, I might estimate that the population mean amount of practice time is between 4 and 6 hours for professional pianists. This is a confidence interval, which is centered around the point estimate of x bar equals 5. The lower bound is 4, and the upper bound is 6. The margin of error is the distance from the point estimate to either the upper or lower bound, and is equal to 1 in this example. Typically, confidence intervals are stated as lower bound, upper bound inside parentheses. My example has x bar, or the sample mean, in the middle, but other confidence intervals might have the sample proportion, the sample standard deviation, the difference of two sample means, or a number of other values in the middle, depending on the problem. Much of the work is related to determining the margin of error, which depends on several different factors, and will be discussed in detail in future videos. There are two generally desirable characteristics of any confidence interval. We desire narrow confidence intervals, and we desire accurate confidence intervals. By narrow, I mean that the margin of error is small. Confidence intervals with large margins of error are useless. If my confidence interval says that professional pianists practice between 1 and 15 hours a day, the confidence interval has such a high margin of error, making it so wide as to be meaningless. By accurate, I mean that we would like any given confidence interval to contain the population parameter of interest with a high level of confidence. Generally, we specify this by a confidence level, such as 90%, 95%, or 99%. Higher levels of confidence, such as 99%, mean that the confidence interval has a higher chance of actually containing the population parameter. It's important to remember that confidence intervals can vary, but population parameters are fixed. A confidence level, such as 90%, is a statement about the confidence interval, not about the population parameter. For example, let's say that the population mean of some population is 100. In the real world, we would never know this value, which is the whole reason why we compute confidence intervals in the first place. Visually, consider a number line with the mean centered in the middle. Let's look at what 10 90% confidence intervals might look like. We might have one interval that ranges from 98 to 102. I've colored this one in green because it contains the population mean of 100. We might have another one that ranges from 97 to 101. This one isn't centered at 100, but still contains the population mean. On average, in 10 intervals, one of those intervals will not contain the population mean if the confidence level is 90%. Here we see one interval is from 95 to 99, which does not contain the population mean of 100. In reality, we only create one confidence interval and will never know if our confidence interval actually contains the population parameter. All we know is that, with some level of confidence, the interval will contain our parameter. In general, I like the following interpretation of any given confidence interval. We are C% confident that the interval, insert confidence interval here, contains the insert population parameter description here, where the parentheses represent wording that should change with each confidence interval. For example, this 90% confidence interval for average practice time of professional pianists could be interpreted in this way. We are 90% confident that the interval between 4 and 6 hours contains the population mean number of hours practiced by professional pianists. Follow this cookie-cutter interpretation by filling in the blanks, and you should never go wrong. There is an important relationship between the confidence level and the length of the interval. A higher confidence level results in a wider confidence interval, and a lower confidence level results in a narrower confidence interval. Intuitively, this should make logical sense. If I want to be really confident that something I say is correct, I can make more broad statements. A 99.99% confidence interval might predict between 1 and 15 hours of practice per day for professional pianists. Sure, I'm really confident that my interval contains the population mean, but that came at the expense of a very large interval. Conversely, low levels of confidence can create narrow intervals. So if I have a 50% confidence level, I can make very specific claims, but they will be more likely to be incorrect. So I might be 50% confident that the interval between 4.9 and 5.1 contains the population mean practice time of professional pianists. Sure, my interval is narrow and specific, which is good, but there is a 50-50 chance that my interval does not contain the parameter that I'm estimating. The way to bypass all of this is just to take larger samples. The larger the sample size, the more narrow the confidence interval. A 99% confidence interval might be too wide and therefore useless for a small sample size, but it might become more narrow and worth using if the sample size is increased enough. Alright, my friends, that wraps up our introduction to confidence intervals. We will be exploring many more fun and exciting statistical topics that you won't want to miss, so make sure to check out our other videos.